Cody. I'm motioning at my husband, John, that I'm hearing your intro song twice.
This
is a live event, and today I'm going to be teaching you guys how to paint Her Majesty herself, Maleficent. And it's the second computer. So I guess we're live, and I can hear myself. That's complete sure perception. If you're brand new here, what we do is I show you how to create these really fun art projects on canvas with acrylic paint. I show you every step of the process. I paint a thing, you paint a thing, I paint a thing, you paint a thing. But the extra added fun of live is that we have picture in picture. We have my husband, John. Say hi, John.
Hi, guys.
He's there reading comments. So if you have questions, if you're in the middle of a project and something is happening, you can actually ask me in real time. And chances are, if we catch the question, we can answer it. Trick to catching the questions, we have a bunch of moderators. Those are the people with the little wrenches. Mm-hmm. Everybody with the wrenches, wave! Yay! So these are people we've known in our community a long, long time. And if you put your questions in caps, they do their best to capture those and let John know that you're asking the question in the storm that is a live feed, which you guys couldn't possibly imagine even if I described it to you. It's kind of like the early days of Nickelodeon. Mm-hmm. Kind of like that. Any of those Nickelodeon game shows in the early 90s. Pretty much sums up what I think live for John feels like. I have my coffee, my sippy sippy.
I feel like I'm broadcasting on VHF.
Is that what it is?
Yes.
I have some extra special tips today. In the description below, we have the materials list. Links to where you can find those materials. They are affiliate links, but they're links to where you can find those materials. And we have a link to the website where you can find traceables. And this is so important. If you're brand new to painting, if you've just wandered in here because it said beginner painting and you thought, I'm a beginner, I'd like to paint. I don't really think I can paint that, but maybe I can with given the right explanation of it. I don't think drawing and painting are connected. I think they're two separate art skills. I think you can learn drawing whenever you feel like it. But you can actually paint before you can draw. So I have traceables. And we're dorky.
Ooh, they're like, it could be worse. It could be on Betamax.
Could be on Betamax.
Direct this, to beta.
This lesson is dedicated to all of you people who do not color inside the lines, who are maybe talk too loud, laugh too loud, love too much, live too big. Don't sit quietly in the corner when somebody cuts your wings off and steals them and locks them in a castle.
No.
This is dedicated to you who stand up for those you love and are also ever in transition. I think my favorite thing about Maleficent as a character is how many times we've understood her. We understood her when we were young, when I was a young girl. We understood her as the villain, this incredible villain who randomly, for no reason, and we believed in villains like this, didn't we? People who, for no reason, wished us ill and would come and curse our little baby cribs, right? To a more complex character reimagined recently by Disney, where we come to understand there's a story behind Maleficent, and that Maleficent's story is one of growth and transformation, where she herself gets a broader, more complicated concept of love and family and trust. And yeah, I feel some stuff for this movie.
And you know, there's a lot of people here joining us that really feel that way. We've got over 240 people here with us already, and they're just keeping more people coming in here. Cinnamon doesn't get a chance to see the chat, so I try to let her see what's going on over here. Thank you guys for all coming in here. We've got a big crowd of people. There's a couple of really important wishes that they asked us to catch here. Just I know that we've got such limited
space
on there.
We've got a lot of limited wishes on the canvas, but we'll try to catch the wishes. We do wishes on our canvas.
We do.
We do wishes. So if you're seeing those go by and you're brand new here and you wandered in, you're one of our new subscribers. Hi, new subscribers. The reason we have wishes on our canvas on live events is that the act of art is an act of being hopeful and optimistic. And I think in life sometimes we don't feel hopeful, optimistic, or worthy for things going our way. And the act of putting a thought, an idea into a canvas is just saying, I, too, am on the list of people who are deserving of a break or something good or a happy moment. And wishes don't have to be serious. They can be light. All wishes are valid. We can cover what we've got canvas right now.
Why don't you tell me what you got up there?
All right. So I got Lacey's health. Lacey is looking for a solution to her health issues. She's had a health mystery, and she would just like them to tell her what is going on. And I agree. It's nice to know what's happening. Rhonda is really looking to have her blood sugar balanced. And to everyone who's going through blood sugar issues, I just want to say that I wish that for Rhonda and everyone.
If we could squeeze in one for Billy and for moms and for Chris.
Okay. What's the wish for Billy?
For Billy, just put Billy in there. Billy is her little sister. So Shanaz's little sister Billy is undergoing surgery tomorrow for breast cancer.
All right. We're gonna wish her a positive outcome. I'm gonna do a funny little thing where I make happy little boobies.
and Chris, a wish and a prayer there. We had a car accident, and then she's been having a lot of illnesses and things associated, and her husband was laid off, so they just need some love there. And
let's send some love and positivity to them. Diana is going through a huge exam, mm-hmm. and she's wishing for a good result on her exam. Amanda's hand needs a heal. She got a little excited while she was painting, and she harmed herself. And Kara's husband is gone through stroke.
Yeah.
Recently. And then lastly, and I think this is so important, and we haven't really talked about this much, is a relief from asthma. My cousin had asthma so bad that they told us all the time that she wasn't going to make it.
Yeah.
And so her mom went through the first 12 years of her life being told that she wouldn't get through her asthma. The medication was experimental. Everything was dangerous and problematic. And you don't really, like, I can breathe, John can breathe. If you can breathe, you cannot imagine what it's like to live in a world where, for no reason, for mm-hmm. things that are outside of your control, you just lose that ability. It is it's a really stifling thing. And so I'm just wishing air and ease, and everybody's breathing who struggles with air.
Yeah.
And that's a good one for this character, too, because she flies and you need air when you fly.
Yeah. So there's so many wishes coming here, guys. Thank you. We have so many. We have a lot of light keepers and our Sherpettes here that'll capture those wishes and put them on their canvases. And thank you guys for doing that. You know, that really helps a lot. So thank you so much. So
I'm going to show a little eye trick. I'm going to do some sketching talk where we talked about how I sketched in Maleficent and kind of give you guys an idea of how that was done if you want a freehander in. But again, feel like you can go get the traceable. That is no big deal. And no, it is not cheating.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing that I did when I was sketching in Maleficent was that I created this little M shape here. I wanted space on each side of my canvas, and it ended up being, I figured it was about an inch and a half, inch and a quarter of space on each side. And I created this wonderful little M shape. I'm going to draw this in. I'm breaking a rule here. Those who've painted with me for a while, I'm drawing in carbon, but it's because I want you guys to see it. You guys should use chalk, watercolor pencil, pastel pencil, so it disappears into your paint. And then when I got that in, I made a point of putting in my eyes and my eyebrows. Now, here's a trick about it. Your eyebrow always should line up about the corner of your eye. And so if you're drawing your eye in, what I find most people can do is they can draw one good eye. They can do the little arc up. Oh, we all know how to do that line. And then the tear duct, and then it curves down and sort of opens up. And there's a little triangle here. We'll put the ocular shape in here. We're going to get this in, right? The pupil and the iris and all that. Then the lid crease. Once we have those in, we know that our eyebrow lines up to the corner of our eye. And then our arc can be somewhere around. It can be before, at, or after this little iris here. What you're trying to do is create that nice arc, you know. And then we're going to do the inward line of the nose. And this is where most people get really, really caught. This is maybe a big question I get all the time. And now I'm very comfortable drawing its mirror image eye. I don't expect them to be perfect. I don't expect them to match up. But when you're starting out, they can be really asymmetrical. And people are often like, how do I get that other eye in if I'm not quite there in my drawing? And here's a trick I used to do when I was learning how to draw. This eye width that I have here is an inch and a half, and the eye is almost 2.5 inches, right? So this is the eye width I've given her, is about an inch and a half. So I'm going to make an inch and a half mark over here. I have traced. See this right here? How I've traced it?
Yeah.
The eye with tracing paper. This is just something you can get at your local art store. It's not expensive. It's a few dollars, right? And what I can do once I've traced it is I can go make a carbon rubbing. I've traced it in pen so I can really, really see it. Some people do their carbon rubbings very neatly. I'm not neat about it. I can flip it over. and line it up and trace a matching eye. And you can see right there how they would match. Can you see that, John?
Yeah, totally.
Right? And I'm using, you can use, if you need to, you can also draw a leveling line to make sure that your eyes are on the level.
Mm-hmm.
But that's how I get, if I was having trouble with making symmetrical eyes, that's how I would do that. I'm going to make the sister eye over here. You can trace yours on using that trick I just showed you. Or just freehand it in if you're feeling comfortable with that.
Nice. Everybody loves this tip. This is a very, very good one.
Yeah. It really helps. And I did that for a long time. It used to be I could get one half of a face and then I'd flip my paper over to get the other half. And just know it's natural and organic and normal to struggle with getting the symmetry of a face.
Yeah.
Which is why almost everybody can... I do a lot of my painting tutorials of faces on half faces. That's why. Because you can get very good at your half face and then we work into the how do we get both sides of that face.
We use tracing
and
paper.
It's tracing paper and then eventually face math. So her little cow comes out to a point, comes in, and she has these interesting horns that happen here. You can, if you're feeling like you need to get some head shape in before you get your horns in, you can sketch that in loosely to help you. But the horns come out and then they curve back in. I like to think of the horns almost as like Highway Route 66. So as they're closest to me, they're wide and they run parallel to each other, but they narrow in the distance until they taper to a point.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Come over at the same space on this side of the head, and I just make the same shape on the reverse image. I could use that eye trick here to get the other horn.
I'll give them a little... Boop, there we go.
What?
I forgot to add the picture-in-picture. There, oh. They have it now up.
Wonderful. We like to have picture-in-picture because that really, really helps us.
And you can kind of see what you're looking at there. A little reference.
All right. So see, all of that's there, and that's all it takes to get this in. Now, again, I'm sketching it in pencil because the camera's been having trouble seeing the lighter colors. Go ahead and use a watercolor pencil so it blends into your paint and doesn't show through, especially if you're using student paint or craft paint or any of the less expensive paints, because it'll bleed through and it'll annoy you. Yeah. It does really hurt you, and some artists do it on purpose.
Ooh, so Colleen says that baking paper or parchment paper is an excellent source
for
tracing paper in a pinch. So
that is an awesome tip. Everybody thumb up Colleen.
Yay!
And while you're at it, you know, if you're feeling optimistic and you think that eye tip was awesome and I'd like more tips like that all the time for free in art, you could go ahead and subscribe and opt in for notifications. And you could always also give us likes. We like likes.
We like likes.
Think of us like little fish. You shake little likes onto our little pool and then we go nom, nom, nom. Nom, nom, nom.
Sprinkle some likes on us.
Sprinkle some likes on us. And we'll keep making free art videos for you. Because
there's a lot of new people join us today.
Do we have a lot of new people? Thank you all the new community members who've come in and have said, art, I likes it.
Over 255 people here. 258 people. Just keeps a great day. Thank you guys for joining us.
It is a great day. And I love this character. This is a powerful character. So I have here Golden Artist Color Acrylic Glazing Liquid in Gloss.
Now, why do you like this stuff so much?
Okay. This is not sponsored. Though I'm sure Golden appreciates every time I do this, but I don't get anything for it. I just want them to keep making this forever and never discontinue this product ever for any reason.
Yeah, we buy it on Amazon.
Yeah. And also, I can get it at Michael's. My Michael's is now
carrying it. It's always sold out. But it is technically there.
It is technically there. And it's probably sold out because of us. But what this is in acrylic paint, there's stuff that slows your paint drying time down. That's called retarder. And then there's stuff that lets you tint a thin coat of paint called a glaze. And usually these are separate products. The glaze dries really fast and the retarder can't be tinted. But this genius little bottle is both in one. And it makes easy work of many hard acrylic tasks, and I love it, and I wish I'd found it 20 years ago, or maybe they didn't make it 20 years ago. Regardless, I have a little cache of them. And I'm just telling you my honest feeling on this product. That's all that's happening here.
You also like a bunch of that stuff there.
There's a bunch of stuff that I like there. The other thing that I have here is my spritz bottle. This is a micro spritz bottle. They're about $1. I can spritz my palette so it doesn't dry out. And today, I could be using Mars Black paint. But today, for fun, I'm using black colored gesso.
Ooh, why are you doing that?
Well, it's a really great fluid paint. It has a beautiful flow and a really neat matte finish and a great tooth, and I've really been enjoying it, so I'm using it. But either one would work. Mars Black paint or Black Gesso. This is also super cheap.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Weird thing.
It looks different on the canvas. On the palette paper.
And I'm going to use a dotting tool, but I'm going to show you how you can use the back of your brush. So I've got a couple things, and the next thing I'm going to get is, and I'm going to show you two examples of the same kind of brush, a number 10 bright. So notice that these filaments are dark brown. The brush shape is very square. It has a sharp edge. This is called a bright. I like brights because they give me control, and they have a firm filament. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't want to put makeup on with them. And number 10 is just an easy size brush to use.
Gotcha.
That's the whole kit and caboodle. This is a Richeson 7530. Ooh. And this is a Simply Simmons, sometimes called Goldilocks on our channel, number 10 bright.
And oh my gosh, look at that. We have so many cool people that haven't seen
in a while. I'm just going to show one last thing. I'm dipping my brush in water and I'm dragging off the extra water.
Oh, you're going to get the paint in here.
Yeah. Off the extra water. And then while we're painting, because we're going to paint this all in just purple.
Oh, yeah?
We'll say hi to everyone.
Okay.
So I'm dragging off the extra water so the brush is not sopping wet. I've got my glazing liquid if my studio is too hot and dry for the paint to go nicely on the canvas. And it's really about the dryness of the studio. Because I can really throw my studio with just air conditioning. And it's just the Dioxane purple I have here. So I've got titanium white, Dioxane purple, phthalo green shade, cad yellow medium. Get hue. It saves you about $10 on your expense if you have the option. Or student paint is always hue. And then in pro paint, just get the hue to save money. The black gesso and the glazing liquid. And I'm just going to paint in everything around her cowl with this purple.
Oh, cool.
And I'm going to just use the shape of my brush. You can see how the shape of my brush lets me get a nice crisp line, even on the flat. So I can brush this in on the flat like this. Or I can come along the edge of my brush, using the edge of the bristles, to make a nice boundary line. Mm-hmm. Either method of getting this in is great. And you wouldn't think this, but you want a very brushy, strokey background.
Gotcha.
You want the canvas and the brush strokes and all of that to show, because it makes it feel at night like it's glowing. It just does. Just trust me.
Huh.
It's all lit up. The fire, this whole canvas, because we use cadmium, that's why I'm using the real cadmium pigment, but it makes it look like it's a glow. Like my green fire is lit up. All right, you were saying something earlier, and I interrupted you.
I was saying, we have so many new people with us today. We got 284 people hanging out with us right now.
284 people?
You know, and so I saw...
I hope everyone's doing a painting.
I think that there are lots of people painting. I saw Excellent. Honor and Janine and Christy and Kim Mayberry and there's someone... There are a bunch of new people.
Say Nanny some Schaefer, new people's names.
Bryce Lynn and Stephanie... And let's see here. Of course, the Lady Wife, White Fang, has been with us for a few paintings. She's from Norway, I think.
Yeah.
And
yeah, from where many of my relatives come from, Norway.
Yeah. And
via Wyoming. It's very strange.
We have Navy Wife is new. And Ian's one of our resident Star Wars aficionados who likes to joke with me. So and a lot of the other people here.
If you find you're making friends in the chat and you want to keep that energy going, just go check out TheArtSherpa.com.
Oh yeah, thank you.
It's a free website. You can just go by there. You can share your artwork safely. It's a safe place to share your paintings and talk in forums and keep in touch with the friends that you're making here in chat.
And what we mean by that, by safe place, is that it's really a lot of positive feedback.
Oh, yeah, I should explain that. Like,
you know, it's not that we have sharks swimming outside the waters, but you know, it's a place where you can share up your pictures, and you know, we try to give you a lot of control, and we moderate the area, so it's positive feedback. It's not really a place for
critiques or
it's a place for you to share your first artwork and start that journey safely and find other people of like mind and like heart that are there to share their artwork and begin that painting journey as well. Does that sound right?
Yep, it's pretty much it. You summed it up.
All right, so that's what we mean.
John has a not family friendly way of saying it.
Oh yeah.
Be nice.
Yeah, that's right. So yeah, we give our moderators great big ban hammers, and you have the choice of being nice or not being here.
Yeah.
And that's kind of the way we roll.
It's a very bully-free zone, and I like that about it, because I think when you're starting art, I'm just painting this all in purple. I think when you're starting art, it's super important to not get critiques. You can get two glows and a grow.
Oh, yeah.
Which is something I do. If you've never heard of the two glow and a grow system, basically it says, probably you know everything you did wrong in your painting, but you don't know the two things you did really right.
Mm-hmm.
And you might not see the concept that you're nearly about to have a breakthrough that you could grow on. So on the rare occasion that we give that type of insight, it's generally like pointing out a couple things. Hey, did you know you did this really well?
Mm-hmm.
And you're nearly ready to try this new concept and a suggestion of a project that you could do or a video you could watch. And so that's really our only critiquing system. I'm loading up my brush. I'm going to, just in case we have some new painters here, if you'll notice, I don't really get into the paint a big way like this. See this here? Oh. I would never do this because it overloads. See how much paint is on my on my brush? It overloads it. I'm going to wipe it off because it's really too much. And you can see how hard it is to even get off. And when you overload like that, look where the paint's gone. Way up into the metal.
Wow.
And it gets out of my control. I'm going to wipe off my brush on my towel here. So when you're starting out painting, one thing that you want to do is work from the edge of your paint plop and load it on the tip of your bristles here like this. Can you see the bead?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So that's what you're going for, and that helps you, you know, keep control of what you're doing. So sometimes you guys will say, I'm not getting any paint on the canvas, but sometimes you guys will say, I am getting so much paint on my brush, I can't control what's going on the canvas. And that's where that comes from. And you're going to notice that I'm using the glazing medium. You do not have to use glazing medium. You can use this free stuff in the cup called water. Just so you know, don't feel pressure to use any product ever used on this show. I only share what I'm using so that you guys are just informed of what I've got going on. But it doesn't really, you know, it's not like a, you got to use this or you can't get it. Just trying to be transparent.
Yep. Gail's like, do you have some wind chimes going in the background, John?
It does sound like wind chimes. What is going on?
I have some wind chimes going in the background to make some mellow background music so you don't hear my kids destroying all of the plastic toys in the front of their house. I thought that the sound of mellow wind chimes would be much
John
more pleasant.
John has a very, you know what? That's one of our things that it's just, that, yeah, we have soundscapes. I don't.
We could give you other soundscapes. We have ocean, we have rain.
And John takes requests.
We have bad 80s music we can play.
We're going to try to get this done in under an hour, but only because because that helps our closed captioners. We have a lot of our videos are closed captioned by people, not the automatic system, but it does help them if the automatic system takes a pass at it first.
Yeah.
I've got a number 10 here, and I'm going to paint in her cowl in black using the black gesso.
Oh, cool.
Here's some interesting things I found out about the black gesso. The coverage on this is so good. Maybe I'll put out a little, I don't have any. It does a really, one of the issues with black paint sometimes is that the coverage is not so great. It can feel kind of streaky, and it can take a couple coats to get a beautiful matte finish. And on this one, a beautiful matte finish is super essential. And I found that the black gesso is, I'm on a canvas board right here, so it's moving around on me. But this is really economical. This is a really great, if you're painting a lot, way to cut your costs on your painting is to switch to canvas board over canvas. Plus, it helps with storage.
So there's an interesting question that's coming in here. That
I'm so happy to answer an interesting question.
And this is one that I know comes up a lot. So
I'm painting the whole cowl black just in case you guys are keeping up with me, which that is not a requirement because the video will be up after the live is over. So you can paint this in your leisure.
So Kat asks, does black gesso ruin brushes the same way white gesso does?
I think it does.
It does. Now, one of the things that we can suggest is that we have a great video on taking care of your brushes.
Yeah.
And you can help restore a lot of that stuff out.
You really can. I mean, the tooth in the product, but you know, your acrylic paint is hard on your brushes.
Yeah, it can wear on the filaments, but you can get a lot of that material back out of the brush with the right care.
And reshape the filaments with the right care.
Yeah.
So that is ways to restore damaged brush.
No, Denise, this is not, the live show is not over. You're still here with us.
Hi, Denise.
She's like, is the live show finished yet?
So guess what thing we learned, John, that we didn't know?
What did we not know?
This is why John was out scouting with my son, so he missed this information.
Oh no.
When I reschedule an event, because you are out scouting with your son.
Yes.
And return times are, you know, not locked in stone.
Mm-hmm.
When I reschedule it, it erases all of your notification bells.
No.
Didn't know that. No. I didn't know that. So say you went to a video and you were so on point. You're like, I got this down. I got my subscription thing down. I hit the gear. I opted in for everything. And I hit the bell. And then I didn't get a notification. I think that's because I moved the time and it dumps all that data. It's now a new video to the system and you have to rebell.
That's so funny.
I'm writing them like saying that's a feature I would like, is that it notifies you that I've changed the time and re-ups your bell.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's interesting. Honor says that she's got you up on the big screen and she's chatting from her phone. And then there was another interesting comment. Shanaz was like, are you ever afraid of using a new brush because you don't want to ruin it or break it in? You just you want to keep it so perfect.
Yes. Yes.
You know what that, you know, so she's like, I don't want to use my brush. You know what? These guys are awesome.
I'm going to switch to a smaller brush for the small areas on my painting because it'll give me more control. And yeah, I absolutely have that. If you buy, so I love the Silver Brush Company. My mom, if you follow her, that's Ginger Cook Live. She's a big fan.
Yes.
They're a little pricier
mm-hmm.
than the Simply Simmons. And sometimes when I buy a really good one from there for a special job, I do get a little mental about taking care of it. It's a little stressful. It happens. I won't lie to you here. definitely. I've got a number 4 bright here.
Okay.
And that's just giving me more control. One of the things that I do is I'll change brushes to make my job more comfortable. When I taught in a sip and paint, that was one of the things that all the people who come in the paint loved that I would share with them, is that change brushes.
Mm-hmm.
Because what's comfortable for me may not be comfortable for you, and you need to be comfortable in your painting experience.
Yeah.
I'm just loving this. I like painting in her cowl, hopefully. Checking
on
fast.
Oh, you're doing great. There's everybody out here seems to be having a really, really nice time. And just so you know, we've almost been Sherpa.
Really?
Yeah, we were bordering on 288, 299.
You gotta explain to them what Sherpa is, because maybe they'll go grab two of their friends to see it.
Okay, so so you guys, all the new people who are here, when we hit 300, we are Sherpa, sort of like an homage back to being
we're
Sparta.
Dorks.
And yeah, we're very, very much dorks. So here. So at some point when we hit 300, some of the Sherpettes said, "We are Sherpa," and it stuck. So now, when we are Sherpa, whenever we hit 300 people in the room or 300 likes, we like to make the Sherpa dance. So we all put on some dance music and throw and kind of dance and do that. So on that note, if you'd like to comment, subscribe, or share, then we could almost have a double Sherpa moment, because we'd have 300
people.
Which
John comes out every double Sherpa and dances
at least
too.
And I'm in my pajamas. I'm in broadcast pajamas today, which is an MTV t-shirt and sweatpants. And I'm post.
Sorry for my Eddie Murphy laugh.
Side effects of the 80s.
I love being a child of the 80s. I'm not even ashamed. I'm proud. Proud of the crazy I lived through.
Yes. It was so crazy. But yeah, that's what that's all about. So when we you'll see when we hit those 300 numbers, we get all goofy but. We're sort of talking away here while the cinnamon's painting in the black paint.
Well, we're all just painting in the black. Yeah. And I think everybody is pretty clear on how we would paint in the black.
Oh, I've been called on it. Look at this.
What?
It's your turn. We are 300 for sure, and it is time to wiggle your toes and wiggle your nose, because the Sherpa is dancing.
Definitely not a how to dance channel.
we are a how to paint channel, not a how to dance channel.
But if you have to be great at dancing to dance, or great at singing to sing, how sad would your life be?
Yeah, or you don't have to be great. You don't have to be great at painting to paint. This is a beginner's painting show, so we're beginner's dancers. And we'll just say thank you guys for coming in and
no
being Sherpa
YouTubers
with us.
Come to me to collaborate for Dan's no.
No. But we do love having you guys with us, and it is really, really awesome. And we are, I mean, like, took a totally 300 likes and 300 people in the room.
Uh-oh, you have to come dance.
I would come out there.
Come on out. Turn up the jam. Serious art happening here.
Serious art.
So you can see there's a different vibe on the live broadcast over the pre-recordeds a little bit.
We get a little
We
silly.
Do two kinds of lessons here. We do pre-recorded lessons that go up on public access.
And if
television, and then we do these lives.
And if you can't dance, please wiggle your toes and wiggle your nose. I know that we have a lot of our audience out there who may not be able to get up and dance the same as they used to, but you can still wiggle along with us. So,
and if you are here from watching the show on public access, hi!
Hello! For those who have joined us from the land of public television, we welcome you to the strange and unusual.
Yeah, we are definitely Beetlejuice.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We're deep in the dork forest, as we like to say.
Oh, so deep. So deep. So we've got this in. This was pretty easy to put in. I maybe took too long to do it.
Well, we needed a little dance. So we got
the dance time is mandatory. I'm like, so for the dance time.
That was nice. We had a little dance.
All right. So once we have that in, I'm going to rinse my brush out. And I really want to get all my black paint out. You might need to go take your brush to the sink. You know, whatever it takes to get the black out, because this next color you want quite bright. If you have an extra brush, you can like change it out. Right? So that's the thing. You want all of your purple to be dry. Actually, I'm going to hit this with a hairdryer to be sure.
Are you?
Because if my purple isn't dry, the color I'm about to lay on there is going to get grayed out. And it's not going to look like her bright powered up flame that I was going for.
Ooh-hoo. So while she figures out how I broke her hair dryer thing. I'll say thank you guys for coming and liking, comment, subscribing, and sharing, and dancing with us today. And as you can hear, she found the plug. So, got me giggling over here. So thank you guys for coming and hanging out with us today. Really, really love having you guys. And she's just got me laughing. And, you know, it's really special to have you guys hang out with us. Don't forget that we're building TheArtSherpa.com as a place for you guys to be able to go hang out, share your artwork, meet up with your friends, check out all that stuff. And you can go to shop.theartsherpa.com to find out all those cool mugs and hats and stuff like that, that we have. And if you have any requests for any of the stuff that we do that you'd like to see up there, please let us know. That we'll happy to try to work that out. And everyone, big art high fives to Flame Gremlin, our very own Lisa, the moderator, who has curated that shop and made it so awesome.
Oh, Sherpa Shop.
She
definitely
deserves.
I'm wearing a shirt from the Sherpa Shop.
That's a good reason to tell them why I was plugging it. I was just, you know, remembering that we had one.
Yeah.
And I was like, we should talk about that thing. It's there. Oh,
it's there. It's a mystery to us, but it's there.
They love the skull on the table. So that skull on the table came from Kroger. It was in their clearance section.
That's a grocery store if you don't live in the South.
Yeah, it's
in Texas, because we're global.
Yeah, it was.
We have a weird grocery store. Not like a Brico Marché. No.
No. I was like, anytime I see cool stuff that could be set decor, it gets snatched right up and I just bring it home and decorate. Just sprinkle it around.
From the grocery store.
Well, anywhere. I mean, like, I'm in the dollar store.
All right.
Okay, sorry. Back to painting.
Because that's what we came here for. Maybe. Sort of. So I have some phthalo green here and some cad yellow.
Yep.
Right? And again, hue, if you're worried about metal allergies, definitely never eat your paint, because this is poisonous if you eat it. But in general, don't put paint on yourself because you never really know when you're going to have an allergic reaction to it. I'm going to pull out a little of my phthalo green and a little of my cad yellow. And I'm making this sort of like, it's like a radioactive green.
If it feels like it belongs in San Onofre,
you got the right green. And I'm going to come over here with my number 4 bright. And I'm on a very light brush stroke. I'm going to brush stroke up. And then I'm going to reverse direction and flow out. And I'm going to do this dry brush around her mask. And another little back stroke and then up. So fire changes directions. It's really quite... I'm going to pull out a little glazing liquid so I can get even translucent if I need to.
Oh, neat.
Fire likes to change directions, right? So the first thing I can do is very lightly come up around her cowl, right? But she's in the middle of expressing how she feels about what's happened, right? She's not worried what people think of her or that she's raised her voice. Or that, you know, she's powered up. Because she has good reason to be powered up. Because, honestly, that wing cutting off thing was like one of the weirdest, worst things I've ever seen in a movie. I'm so upset about that.
It's like, what are you doing?
So I'm coming in. How I do this is I go swerp, swivel. This reminds me a little bit.
Swerp?
Yeah, say swerp, swivel, swerp. It helps. Technical term.
I think that needs a sticker.
Swerp, swivel, swerp. So I just grabbed a little more yellow into it, and I'm brushing along, right? And I'm going to look here, and I feel like I could come here and come up and down, and curve back. Look, curve back, because flames can curve different directions is what they do. They don't play fair. Power-ups don't play fair. They're not like, hey, let's be orderly. Let's line up in little ridges. They go around.
So, can you comment on how golden glazing compares to Liquitex matte medium?
They are totally different products.
Oh, I thought so, but I think that someone was...
Okay. So, Liquitex matte medium is an incredible paint extender. I talk about that a little bit on my palette knife, Rainy Cityscape, and I've talked about it on the Big Art Quest, which you can just go follow the videos, and we talk about mediums, extenders, blenders, those types of things. And how they're different. So matte medium by Liquitex, or really any acrylic company, because everybody has a matte medium, is used as an extender, which means I can take a little bit of my color and mix it into it. It's basically the lake, the body of the paint without pigment.
Okay.
Right? So it's like you all the stuff that's in your tube, if you took all the pigment out, matte medium is very similar, as I understand it, in formulation to that. Is that how you understood it too?
I think so.
We went through the same explanation from a very brilliant paint chemist who was like explaining the chemistry of this to us and the polymer chains and how they hook up. But basically, that's what it is. Heavy bodied mediums have a lot of body, right? They'll really hold a peak. They don't do what's called leveling or self leveling, they don't shrink down as they dry, they hold their full body. Matte medium does exactly what your paint would do in the tube like this, right? Soft gel is self-leveling. It does what a soft body paint would do.
Gotcha.
And that also extends it. And if you do matte, it means it's not shiny and it's a little bit opaque, so the color tints in it a little bit easier. Gloss can tend to be a little bit opaque. I mean, translucent, but it makes a better acrylic skin. And you can make tons of acrylic skins with matte medium.
Interesting.
Does that make sense? Whereas this here, this is a glaze. So I can tint this, but it's very soft bodied. It's self-leveling, and I can like glaze it and thin glazes over. And it's a retarder, which means it slows down how fast my paint dries in the conditions. So like I'm in dry conditions, my paint wants to dry real fast.
Yeah.
This prevents that and allows me longer time to blend and work my paint. But most products don't do it in the same product. That's the only one I have found so far that does it in the same product.
Interesting.
Otherwise, I'd have to have a bunch of different products out here, which gets on my nerves. It does. Well, because it starts taking up your space, and you're like, I have so much stuff out here.
Yeah.
John C. Me had these little frustrating moments in my studio where there's too many products.
Yep. So actually...
I've made a more irradiated green, and I'm coming back into my flame. I'm gonna come. You see me come forward and then reverse direction. And then sometimes I just flame out like that. Really play with these brush strokes is my advice. Experiment with them. It takes a little while. It's like calligraphy. It takes a little bit to get a deft hand at it. But it's not something everybody can't master. This is not a talent-based skill. I'm going to come here and make a little boundary of my green. And then come back and create the dancing part. So like right here, I might come out. Woo! Make a little flame. See?
Yeah.
Flaming it out. Flame it out. Flame it out. Okay, was there another question?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so MV Mills says, I'm trying to use up my student paint before I go buying a bunch of more higher quality paint.
Smart move.
And having issue with the paint not covering the canvas.
Yeah.
Advice on that?
So there's some tricks that you can do. Treat your student paint like it's all glazes. If you paint with your student paints and your craft paints as if they're glazes, if they're a little bit translucent, because essentially they are lighter in the pigment, it will help you recognize it takes two coats. You can add white to your paint. And it pastels it up a little bit, but can extend the color. You can sometimes do some color mixing. So like when I was teaching you some paint, I would take the phthalo blue and a little bit of the burnt sienna, and I'd mix a little bit of the burnt sienna into the phthalo blue to give more coverage. Because there was a little more pigment in the burnt sienna than there was in the phthalo blue. Yellow never has enough pigment in the student paint, and I always have to add white to the yellow, and sometimes I have to add red. Because always. And yellow ochre also is good to add to the colors to cause them to go longer. So if your burnt sienna is a little thin, add a little yellow ochre to it. It's an interesting deal.
Cool. And we've got some,
the big color chart, that color chart.
Yeah.
So in the Big Art Quest, we have this thing where you make this color chart with the paint you have. It is about not buying new paint, but it's about taking the paint you have and making the color chart so you know what your paint will do.
Right.
So you can do anybody's YouTube tutorial, anybody's workshop, anything, and get what you need out of the products that you have.
Right. So yeah, check out the Big Art Quest if you're, you know, so any of those paints, like the, you know, the Walmart apple barrel paints or any of the Michaels paints, any of those kinds of things, you can figure out how to make all of them work.
And that's really the point, because like, you know, you might not have access to certain products or whatever, and you've got to make what you have work. And you got to remember, artists will paint with coffee.
Oh yeah.
And I've seen great works done with apple barrel paint. So don't let your product be a limitation on what you can do. Just realize what its strengths are, get to know it, and then make it do what you say, like Maleficent is doing right here.
Yes. Yes.
So you can see that my brush is very dry. I'm skipping over the canvas. I'm skipping over. I'm coming around on the edge of my brush here. And then I'll go to my flat. I'm just trying to allow a lot of this purple to show through. The fire is thickest near her cowl. The power-up magic.
Ah.
And, you know, let your brush strokes be loose and whimsical if you want it to feel like fire. See how the whimsical brush strokes
give
it a fiery effect? We've done a lot of fire on the channel, and we'll keep doing fire. Because I think it's an effect people like to know how to do.
Now, if you didn't
this is the first time we've just done a non-yellow-red fire.
Yeah. So now, if you don't have black gesso, it's okay to use black.
Yeah, paint. Mars black.
Mars black, yeah.
Yeah. Or bone black or whatever black you have. We have a quest on black. What we keep talking about when we're saying quest is we have a weekly long quest that goes on where we talk about all the products in the art store and what all the stuff actually does, so you can know what all the blocks are about.
Yeah, and
or all the gels or products or.
It's a playlist here on YouTube, and you can go check that out. And on our website, we're actually building out a group and a series of activities around those quests, so that it'll help curate that and make it a little easier for you to understand its progression and you know,
because you just use it as you need it.
Yeah.
It's your quest. So you just take on the classes. If you're like, what is all this black about? Then you go take the quest on all the blacks. And then you're like, oh, that's what the deal is. Ebony and ivory. So I'm just, you can see I made that little C here. And then I came up to a point and came back. That's a nice flame shape. Sometimes people just like to do like flames, you know, like that. Where they just curve them out like that.
Oh,
that
yeah.
works too. You know, So just enjoy it. It's great when some of the flame is more yellow.
Get down there and see that.
What is interesting is in low light, the flames will glow.
Oh, yeah, because the cadmium.
Yeah. Why do artists use cadmium? True cadmium pigments, if it's remotely possibly toxic. Because it's awesome. Me and Bob know this. Me, Bob, and Thomas Kincaid all know your windows don't glow at night without the cadmium. But look, the hues are very approximate, comparable colors, especially in the pro paints. Students only offer you hue, and hue has no cadmium in it. Zero. It's just pigment. Don't eat it. No paint is safe to eat. Unless it's like edible paint. It says like, this is paint for eating. And even then, I don't trust food dyes. Do you trust food dyes?
I do not.
Okay. Keep it out of your mouth, eyes, and lungs.
Yeah.
That's my advice. I'm going to do a whole thing on paint safety. But it's non-toxic, and it's not going to jump through your skin. And as long as you're not allergic, it's perfectly safe to use. And just don't eat it.
Now, you could glow paint this, too, yeah?
Oh, you could glow paint this all the way.
That'd be fun.
All right. So her, I feel like she's fired up. She's got some nice fire. If you feel that there's any way she needs some more fire, you can come back and, you know, paint in her fire. Or you feel like she needs some more power up. Go ahead and, you know, work that in if that's needed. If you're not getting good coverage, add white to this mixture.
Okay.
If you're having trouble painting over the purple, the pro paints let me paint over the purple.
Oh, nice.
Like, I don't have to think about it. If I was doing student paints, it might be a little bit harder. I'd have to add some white to the mixture. I'm rinsing, rinsing, rinsing. I might need some new water, babe.
Rinsing, rinsing, rinsing.
Because it's so... All right. So, I've got to do the eyes. To get good access to the eyes, I can do two things. I can flip the canvas over.
Isn't that cheating?
No. And I can paint this upside down, or I can raise my easel way, way up. I can change the position, but I always want to paint the space that's comfortable for my shoulders, back, arms, wrists, everything. Just saying.
Do you want that adjusted up, or do you like it upside down?
I think for the purposes of them seeing how I paint it, you might want to adjust it up.
Okay.
I'll let John do that. Adjust it up. Yeah. We're having to... This is a European best easel. This is by the Richeson company. My family's painted on this brand of easel since I was knee-high to a grasshopper. And I like them. There's other great easel companies. This is just the one that's good. Super familiar with. This thing is way bigger and more substantial than this job is required. I used to paint professionally. I guess kind of in some ways I still do. But this is for big canvases. Yeah, you need at least one new paint water. I can keep using that one to work it on. And there are ways to dispose of your paint water ecologically, and there's a bunch of videos about that if you're a green painter. Actually, I think probably watercolor is a better choice, but, you know, either way, there's ways to mitigate your environmental impact as an artist. It's a lot of times why I reuse towels to wipe my paint off. Because if I wipe my paint off on the towel first, once the paint is dry and inert in the towel, it's everything that's in the paint is sealed into the polymer of the paint. It's not seeping. People smarter than me told me that. And honestly, it's probably true.
Yeah.
I'm going to take a little of my black gesso over my white. I don't want that much because I want a very, very light gray. See how it takes very little to tint my white? And I want just a dovey gray. I want just off-white. I looked at Maleficent quite a lot online, different fan art versions of her, concept art versions of her, Angela Jolie's version of her, and she has very pale, grayed out skin, probably because she's fairy.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't you love how that answered, like, where she came from and, like, what the deal was? I was always like, that's a really strong reaction and not getting invited to a party, but okay. Like, I don't get invited to parties all the time, but I don't feel like I got to kill everybody.
Trying to get that centered there for you.
Huh?
Just centering up that picture there for you.
Because of the robot cam?
Yeah, using RoboCam over there.
Is it working? Is this messing it up?
No, we're doing okay.
Okay, cool. So I'm just going to very carefully paint around my objects. I'll come back with some black with this light gray paint. You could paint in your black lines if you're afraid of losing them. You know, to keep them. And that might be a good idea. I might show you how you do that right now. Because I'll keep mine. I'm pretty confident with it. But you might be like, I feel like I'm losing it. I'm going to get a very small brush. Detail brushes are awesome. This is a number two shader. A small detail that comes to a point. Like this. This is a zero detail. Any of these work for this job. I'm going to load up this brush. And I'm going to just make sure that the lines that I would feel a little lost without are kept here. So maybe I'll do that right now.
Now, those towels that you use to wipe your brush off, can you throw those in the laundry?
You just throw them in the laundry and you wash them and they come out. And again, they're okay.
But now it isn't going to get the paint out. Once the paint's dried on there, they're...
Yeah, it's pretty much in there. You get some of it out. It keeps them usable.
But, you know, you just kind of break the paint open and, once it's dry.
They stick with you for years. I'm telling you what, you can have some towels that have some real personality. Like, you'll have towels that you'll know what kind of color palette you were working in for a period of several years. Because the towel takes on the quality of that time of your painting.
So Ian was asking.
You could use paper towels, too. I just
reuse
towels because it's an area where I could be more.
Well, you can get inexpensive shop towels at most auto parts supplies. Those red towels are really inexpensive, and they're designed to get absorb grease and then be kind of thrown away.
Yeah.
And they work great for paint towels, too. So red shop towels.
Exactly.
My little secret there.
You just got to pick what's right for you.
Now, Ian was asking, is that easel the same as an Oxford-style easel?
I have to check on that for you. I think
there's
a difference. But I think it's in the tray. I'm going to have to look at that for you.
Yep. So.
But I will get that. I will get that to you, Ian. I'll post that. I don't know.
So
we're going to cover this stuff during the easel quest. The thing about the easel quest, which has been challenging, is I have a lot of easels, but they're all best. And I think I've just got to collect some pictures of the different easels is what I've got to do. And then we'll talk about how they're different. One of my favorite things on easels is, he's probably going to be in like my review video, but Nigolero, Rick Nigolero.
Yes.
He's Swedish. He builds easels out of branches. I'm just never going to stop talking about that because it's still cool. He doesn't carry his easel out into the wild. He just goes out into the wild, builds an easel with some branches.
Well, because, it's just wood.
Because he's awesome.
Yes.
Just saying.
And I think that, there has to be, and I think that they must have an awesomer word for awesome because it is Nick.
Yeah. Rick.
I try.
I don't know why you want to rename him.
You know what? I want to rename everybody, so it's
you
okay.
You do. It's just not even personal.
It's like, Janine can't be Janine, and Lisa can't be Lisa, and Kim can't be Kim. They all have to be somebody else.
It's a problem. How are we doing? Are we good on questions while we're getting this in? So I'm just showing you how I might leave in these lines just in case it was easy for me to lose them. This is another way that I could do this before painting in the gray. And that might help me not lose my way in the canvas if I were feeling new and not as confident. Sometimes that's what happens to me is I'm like, I'm feeling pretty confident and then I got to think to myself, what is your experience like in this canvas?
So there's a couple of good questions that have come up here.
Oh,
so,
I love answering questions. It's like my favorite thing.
Continuing
even when I
on there.
I get to look it up.
So Kimmy wants to know, do you guys have a certain amount of time in these videos or can you just do whatever you want here? And I guess the answer is we have as much time as YouTube allows us.
Yeah, which is 24 hours.
Yeah, which is a lot.
Yeah. And we're longer than you guys want to paint.
Yeah.
You guys will definitely be done before YouTube says we're done.
So Sarah Jones says, hello, Cinnamon. How are you? You're awesome.
Hi, Sarah Jones. You're awesome, too.
And Sally says,
brush off. It's getting all glopped up.
Is it? So, and You do that just to make sure that your bead stays nice and clean.
Yeah, if the paint starts creeping up my brush, I do that to get control over it.
Yeah. So, Sally, and it looks like we're at 55 minutes, so we're probably not going to make
We're
going
to probably be at about an hour 15.
Yeah. So this one will go a little longer than an hour.
Sorry to the closed captioning volunteers. Every time I go over, I always feel so bad. Somebody closed captioned a five-hour video.
Oh, my gosh.
The Bell Dome.
Oh, my gosh.
The Raphaelite painting.
Mm-hmm.
We thought it'd be fun to show you guys how you could do a Raphaelite painting.
Was that really 5 hours?
It was 4 hours and 50 minutes. I was so tired.
Wow.
Angela was like, what were we thinking? I'm like, I don't know.
That was the craziest thing. So,
isn't it?
Yeah, let me go back on here. More things. Oh my gosh, Judy, are there uses for worn out brushes?
Yes, so many. Never throw out your worn out brushes. Keep them like the treasure they are.
Send them to the brush sauna first. They got to go to the brush spa.
Check and see if the brush sauna will recover them, because a lot of times brushes you guys say are done, I can get back to new.
Yeah. Some
good... if the brush sauna doesn't work, and I need to make a whole nother video, the brush sauna.
Yeah.
Where brushes are restored from certain death.
Mm-hmm.
So the black paint picked up on my brush, happening here is I'm just leaning into it.
You're just kind of blending
whatever.
It in.
Whatever. I'm like, all right, fine, you fussy, fussy thing. What you should actually do, if you discover that you have paint you don't mean to have, you should wipe it off on your brush and start over.
So
you should not do as I do there, because I know how to get out of that problem, and you might not.
So Sanjo was asking, can I mix cheap craft paint with high quality paint?
Tell the paint companies I told you this, but yes.
Yes.
Yes. You should be able to mix 90%, you know, and that's not a scientific percentage. That's an emotional percentage that I'm just throwing out to you right here.
Mm-hmm.
But what I'll say is, in my experience, I haven't run into an acrylic product that was not friendly to another acrylic product for acrylic. If it's a product designed for acrylic,
mm-hmm.
they should be interchangeable.
And if I can add to that, most of the pro paints are designed so well that they can suck up the deficits of the more inferior paints. So
it's really amazing.
And oftentimes you can extend your really nice paint, your painting project with some of those other paints in there, especially the whites and the blacks.
Exactly.
So, but good. It's amazing what these good quality paints, the science that goes into them, the polymers, the binders, you know. These guys are really, really good at what they do.
Also be aware, companies like Mod Podge are no joke.
Oh, yeah.
And they're very serious about what they make. So mm-hmm. it's not a pretentious thing. It's just what companies are very serious about what they do and what ones are fly by night.
And use it for a purpose. I mean, you wouldn't use Elmer's glue as an extender. One is a glue and not a extender. So you don't interchange those things, but when they're designed for it, man, they do really good.
Something just fell and I don't know what it fell from, and I'm so worried, but that's okay. I'm gonna paint inside my eyeballs now with a gray, but around the pupils. I'm coming inside here. So it's interesting, her skin is gray and inside the eyeballs is gray, and it's going to be a tonal study that lets us make these different. I do a lot of eyeballs on my channel. And I actually think eyeballs are okay for beginners. Also, I think that beginners want to know how to do eyeballs. So I like to cover it a lot. If you're new here, have fun with that. And if you've been here a while, you're like, yep, she likes her an eyeball. Mm-hmm. Eyeballs all the time. Switch to a smaller brush. You have some control over for this next portion of the painting. All right, we're going to switch to a smaller brush.
Yep.
And I'm going to start actually working the grayscale part of this painting. So I'm going to mix a mid-range gray. So if you imagined that you had shades of gray, this being 1, this being 10, this would be like a 5. 10 shades of gray.
There's 50. So many good questions that are coming in.
So I'm taking this gray and I'm kind of at the inside of this eye adding this shading. Because what I want to do is I want to shade this eyeball like it's round. So it needs to be kind of darker at the edges near the lid, and then lighten as it gets near the light source, which would be coming here, lightening it. And then again, it's dark right under the lid because the lid casts a shadow. And then I'm going to get this darker, like, 7 shade of gray. You're going to want to shade the outer edge here to the corner with this, not black, you don't want it to be black, but a darker shade of gray. I'm going to get to the question John's got. I haven't forgotten.
Oh, no, there's a... See, I
hear it. I hear it. I'm just also shading the thing, shading this inside here.
You know, we have so many questions, guys. We try to get to all of them, and we're real sorry that we can't catch all of them every day. But if you leave them in the comments after the show, then we go back and try to capture those for our Sunday shows and catch up on any questions that we miss.
So I'm taking like a shadow, like a mid shade of gray. This isn't black. Like if it was black, it would be too dark. Let me show you. Like right there, that'd be too dark. I'm going to wipe off my brush and get some white paint and kind of shade that out.
And I want to give you some love there, Cinnamon, because we've got over 310 people and 370 likes going on right now. Huge number of people.
Likes. Nom, 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 nom. Nom. Feed us likes. I don't know. It's been making me happy all day. I saw it somewhere and I was like, that's so funny. Nom, nom, nom. Oh,
and now we have a broadcast head mic.
What? What?
So now I shall strike my head with a mic.
Oh, are you?
Yes.
Okay, be careful. That thing is hard. So the real, you know, I'm just trying to use this gray to shade this eyeball. This is a bit of work, you know, but don't let it intimidate you. What you're going to want to be doing is make sure that this part of the eyeball, this outer part, is the lightest. See how I grabbed some just white paint to shade it? A little bit underneath the pupil and then around here. That's what you're doing. And then you're going to want the dark part to be like, this would be a dark gray right here. See? Right to this outer crease. And then I'm going to get some more of the dark part here and right here. Isn't it interesting how when I start creating that shading, it starts creating a definition of the eye?
It does.
It's wild. And this would be like the tear duct area, so I need it to be a little bit lighter. Hear my kids laughing. Then the gray. At least they're happy.
They're being strung up by their toes and tickled.
I think that they're...
I think they're
rebelling. A little worried. So I'm just making sure that I've got this highlight here around the iris. And that's the trick. You have a shadow that comes across here. It's shadowed here and then back there. And so I'm just constantly working my black and white to create those spaces. So I've got not black, but pretty dark, and I'm starting to talk about that shape there. I'll be coming back and defining, like makeup, the outer edges of the eye. And if you're good at makeup, you're going to find that part real easy. Again, making sure that there's a nice line, a definition here.
They believe that there should be a reflection of Kevin the Kraken in her eyes.
It's a good belief. If you're new here, we have a Kraken. It was recently pointed out to me that it's crazy I don't have a llama mascot.
It's true.
I have a Kraken mascot, and I have a gnome mascot. There's a dragon that comes.
There's a dragon.
There's some we even stuff have some that comes up, but we haven't
zombies?
Had a llama.
We've got zombies.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Everything but a llama. What's going on?
Our friend Lindsay just came in. Hey,
hi,
Lindsay.
Hi, Lindsay. How you doing, girl?
I just looked up to see her.
So I'm...
Oh, and Chris Play Games is here, too.
Chris Plays Games. Hey, guys. I'm going to line her eye. If you guys do liner, this is like your jam. If you guys don't do liner, it's a nightmare. But what it is you want to use a small brush and a fluid paint. See, the gesso here is very fluid, so it doesn't fight me. It's not that I'm a genius of lining. I just have a good tool and a good product.
Ah.
That's all that's happening. Good tool, good product. So I'm coming along here, and I'm just making sure the lining here will be thicker on the outside edge. I'm coming along the top line of the eye. This is not dissimilar to my owls. You guys have done my owls, one of my many, many owls. You're like, hey, wait, I feel like this is like I've done this on an owl eye. You have.
You've done this on
had
an owl eye?
I plan for you all along. If you think about it, we've done lips, we've done eyes, we start doing noses. I might be taking you guys on a face train.
Now, this is a first. I think this is awesome. So Chris has just told me that he's going to be listening while he drives. But he wanted to say hi before he jumped, before he, you know, on
jumped
chat.
Jumped in his car. You definitely be eyes on the road. We don't want to be like Pokemon Go over here.
Yeah, we have enough people. What are you doing there with your just painting?
Okay, you know what I did? I didn't think of it. This is now why you now know when my canvas is colorful. I have too much paint on my brush, so I've just absentmindedly gone, get off on my easel. I do that, and I'm going to just define the shadow just a little bit because I don't feel like it's defined enough for what I'm about to do.
Okay.
I'm loading up just a dry brush here, and I'm going to do the same thing here and the same thing to the outer edge. Now, I'm going to do an interesting thing. I'm going to come over my purple. I'm going to pull my purple out, but I haven't rinsed my brush, so my black is on it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to get into my glazing. You could also just do a very dry brush, but what you want is see-through pigment. And I'm going to come here on the inside of the eye, and I'm going to just very lightly dust this grayed purple.
So clearly,
like a tart makeup.
This is the Sherpa makeup tutorial.
This is the Sherpa. This is how you do makeup. This actually would work on your eye, by the way. So
you're gonna have a bunch of Sherpettes giving us the Maleficent eye.
If you want to know how to do the Maleficent, this is the weirdest way to do a makeup tutorial ever.
With glazing liquid.
But I could literally do this on my own eye. It's the same thing, just squishy canvas. Skin is squishy canvas that moves and sometimes yelps.
So I think that's awesome.
Super annoying. Do they stay still like they're supposed to? No. All right, I'm going to pull out some just purple pigment and some white pigment, and this is going to give me a brighter color.
Mm-hmm.
Because you would always want to have a bright color on the inside of the eye.
Ah.
Lined here.
So I guess this is called...
That opens up the eye, doesn't it?
Is this a smoky eye?
Dude, Maleficent is the queen of smoky eye. Her eye is so smoky, okay. It actually flames. I'm going to show you how to do the power up on her eye.
Mm-hmm.
Can't help myself. It's too much fun. All right. Sorry, I guesstimated wrong on her time.
That's okay.
So I'm pulling out some black, and I'm getting back into my purple, right? And again, I'm going to show you the dry brush. I'm going to not get any glazing medium, just in case you don't have it at home. And what you would do if you didn't have it at home is just do a dry brush like this. See how it's just dusting the canvas, picking the top of the canvas up? I'm just dusting it to give that smoked out effect. So you can do glazing medium, right, which is a smooth blended effect, or you can do a dry brush. These are two ways that you get blended effects in acrylic paint.
Okay.
There are other ways. These are not the only ways. These are just some ways. I'll show you some of the ways. Unless we're going to do a 24-hour live stream, not all the ways.
Don's like, tell Chris to plug his phone into his stereo. He has a new Jetta, I think.
Oh, somebody's GTI. Jetta familiar?
No, he has a new...
Volkswagen.
Yeah, it's a new Volkswagen GTI. It's got the Super Sport package with all of the...
like you do.
Yeah, and he had all the stuff in there, so I was watching his video on it. He'll work it out, I'm sure. He'll be the first one that has like the voice-activated talking...
Yeah.
For sure, in there.
I mean, who would besides Chris?
Me?
Let me tell you who you want to be trapped on a desert island with if it all goes pear-shaped. Chris. Zombie yes. Apocalypse, go find Chris. All right. So
genius.
He's the most likely to get the power back on. All right. So I've got my black and purple, and I'm coming back here, and I'm going to just blend out what would be the lid. See how I'm blending out what would be the lid?
I do.
And then I'm going to come here underneath this sort of lash line. I'm blending out here, coming back underneath, darkening that up with the purple. We're doing makeup with our paint, for sure. That is all that's happening here. I'm blending to the midpoint of the eye. And up the lid, shading the lid. We've got the crease shaded with the black line, right? Make sure we're blended. A little highlight here, and then we're going to come behind the crease here and just make sure that this is smudged out. Look at us go making makeup on this eye. Isn't that cool?
That is.
It's kind of cool. So she's got kind of a smoky eye happening now. Fun thing that we get to do next, we're going to take our green, just our green, and we're going to paint the whole eyeball this bright green around what the pupil would be.
We've had such a fantastic turnout here today. I just wanted to let you know, Cinnamon. Cinnamon doesn't get to look at the chat.
I don't.
We take the chat away from her.
Chat is what because I do. I'm chatting.
She reads the chat and then talks and does not paint. And so I'm not exactly sure.
This is not what you guys showed up for.
And right now, we're almost double Sherpa, which is where we get 400 likes or 400 people in the room. In this case, we just hit double Sherpa. We got 400 likes here.
Okay. So do you have to dance again?
I think we should. Let's put on a little dance music. Okay. I think that would be worth a little attention.
A little bit? Think so?
I can get some. And look at that. See the eyes starting to creep up over that. Looking pretty good. And for all of you who are at home, wiggle your fingers and wiggle your toes because we got 400 likes today, guys. Thank you so much for coming and hanging out with us. We really, really, it is not the same without having you guys here with us. And I mean, we have a lot of fun being able to put these guys up here, but having you here makes this so much more fun for us. We really, really appreciate it. So thank you for coming and hanging out. And you know, please leave a comment in below. Anything you guys want to see, we want to know, you know? So let us know.
Hathead.
Do more music. No bass lines.
Yeah. Okay. Because we weird.
Because that's what we do.
Next thing we're going to do is we're going to get a little of our kind of radioactive green we mixed earlier. Because, you know, that's what we do at the end of a dance.
The chat's just going crazy. If you guys haven't been to a live chat, we highly suggest it.
We recommend you do it.
And if you can't make it to them, this seems so weird.
I'm sure this is highly irritating without the context of the live chat.
And if you can't make it to the lives, do check out theartsherpa.com. We've got forums and groups and new things that I can't yet
say. We go to live chats. We go to the Frugal Crafters live chat.
Oh, yeah.
Lindsay, who was here, she has one on Fridays.
She has a live chat. And
Chris Plays Games. We go to his live chat.
Yep.
It's a very interesting live chat.
Angela Anderson.
I actually like his live chat because we get to talk about TV shows.
We talk shop there. There's some inside baseball there as well, which is really fun.
I like Lindsay's also because you can get tips almost on any art product.
Okay. So if you wanted to know anything about anything in the art store, go check out one of Lindsay's, which I'm sure it's 1,300 videos now. You know,
so many
videos. She is the frugalist of
every
crafters.
Time I start thinking I have too many videos. I just recently had somebody you're uploading too much, you're draining my battery.
Yeah, because the notifications.
I'm not even keeping up with the Frugal Crafter.
Yeah, she's 3-1 on us.
No, I got another coat of green because it's going to take a couple coats of green to just really pull up the deep outer ring. You want eyes to have a deep outer ring. They don't always, but on the whole, you're going to find when you're dealing with the pigment of eyes that they often do.
Oh, they think that we're living it up with the emphasis on the eye.
I know, man. I'm teasing myself. I like eyeballs. And so we're not even at the end of eyeballs. If you guys were thinking, I'm so over eyes, all that's going to happen is more mouths with the eyes. But I haven't shown
and
you
noses,
how to do crying eye.
Ears.
With tears coming out of it. I haven't shown you all the different ways to do different color eyes because they're not the same. I haven't covered all the weird animal eyes that you can deal with.
Lindsay said it's more 1,500 now. So
is
it's just
1,500?
Wow. She
tripped me out.
She was thanking us for the shout out, but it was just like last time you look over there, she's so prolific.
She's
it's
my
awesome.
Other Google.
Yeah, it's amazing
it
art
really
over
is.
There. So
it's something, and you just don't, you know. I mean, it's incredible that it's here. We're just really lucky to all have all this resource. We really are. So I'm just dusting this outer ring with the paint. I'm going to rinse this out, and I really need to put my pupil in. That's going to help me anchor this. And I need to anchor my eye with my pupil. You know, it's just a Reiki dealing.
So she can see.
So she can see. Seeing is very helpful to your characters. They will want to do it.
And look, there's I love this particular track because it reminds me of like every bit of 80s music that was in a video game ever.
Ever?
Yeah. Like, you know, Bad Dudes or any of the side-scrolling fighting games.
So one of the things I want to make sure is that it feels like there's a shadow that's coming down from my lid across the top of my eye. So I have to make sure that my lid is low enough for that shadow. So you can kind of see how it's touching my pupil. Right? It's touching my pupil. I'm going to rinse this off while that's setting and drying, and I'm going to come back and add some more like highlights. I'm going to actually get into my white and a little bit of my yellow, so it's quite bright. I want like almost a crazy ducky color. And I'm going to come and just dab. If you'll notice, there's like little dabs. It's not a solid thing. It's little spots of this yellow.
Yeah. Smaller dabs are better than bigger dabs.
Yes.
You can control them.
So I am, because it doesn't get away from you.
Yeah.
Right? It's okay if there's a little green on your brush. I just grabbed some more yellow because it was too light. Because I do want it to feel like yellow here. And I still want the green to show through. Because we're trying to give her eyes some empowerment. And so that's what I'm trying to do, is power up those eyes, right? Girlfriend has said no.
I love this picture. She's just peeking up going, what's up?
I love that it's at the end here. It's going to be an interesting framing thing for any framer. So in this case, I'm going to use my glazing liquid. You could just do a very fine dry brush. But what I want is a see-through gray.
This would look awesome in a floating frame.
And I'm going to add a shadow under the lid about an eighth of an inch to a quarter of an inch down across the eye.
That's the I'm looking at you shadow.
Yeah. You know, you just need a little bit of it. It's not, you don't want it to be black. You want it to just be, see how that does?
Yeah.
I'm just going to keep pulling that down, keep shadowing that up. We just want that across there. It's okay. What's interesting is, like, I don't even worry if the shadow comes from the green. I just want the value. And gotcha. This is something I like from Carol Marine. Carol Marine has been like, doesn't matter what color you use, as long as you have your values together. And honestly, I find that often to be true.
Yeah.
That it just doesn't matter what color I'm using, as long as my value kit comes together.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to add some eyelashes. I'm going to use this shader, this number 2 shader. You can use a detail brush. Well, actually, I might even show you, like this one, this number 0. Maybe I'll switch this number 0 to show it to you.
Yeah.
I've got my fluid paint, my gesso in this case. You could use a lot of different products. You just want a soft paint. And I'm curving these lines up. Now, how I get my eyelashes, how my eyelashes are successful, I'm going to show you here. I press and then flick. My brush stroke is always lighter at the end of the stroke. So it gives me that tapered lash look. And they're not like perfect as I'm pulling them out. It's a very light brush stroke. See that?
Yeah.
Super easy. And I'm going to come and add some underneath here like you do. Because, I mean, no point in putting on all this, like, fairy makeup and not hit some mascara.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe she's using some of those new lash products. I don't know. I should know. It's my painting, but I don't know. In my story, we're, like, virtual strangers. So I'm coming here, and I'm just adding these strokes. I actually, for me, have to stroke from the outside in, coming back from the left side.
Hmm.
To keep control of where I'm going. Also helps prevent my wrist from dragging through wet paint.
I don't know. I think Maleficent looks like a Mac girl to me.
Really?
got her fly eyelashes on.
All right. Too many 80s movies right there is what that was. You guys may not know that, but that's what that was.
Too many 80 movies. It's
that's
true.
The only reason he even knows that. He doesn't really actually know what that even means.
Yeah. You know what? Everyone else in chat got the joke, so it's okay.
We're all... So I have fluid white. You could use your heavy-bodied white. The trick is you want it to be soft enough to flow, right? So on this, I can still kind of do it, but see how it'll hold a peak? I don't know if you can catch that, but it'll hold a peak, and you might not want that. Can you see on the...
Yes, hold on. There it is.
How it is? It holds a peak?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You totally can see it.
That can mess with you. Now, you can use a nail tool with a little... We've done that before where we had the little nail tool.
Oh, yeah.
Or you can use the back of a detail brush.
So what are we going to do
there? But you're going to want to go...
Oh, yeah.
Dot, dot.
Oh. Dang. That's cool.
Dot, dot.
Okay. That's it, huh?
Yep. You'll get a little more control from your nail tool than you will from your brush, but it still works. The other thing that you're going to want to do is you're going to want to load the tip of your brush, your detail brush, with your white. You're going to want to make a reflection here in the tear duct and a little bit right there. And you're also going to want to come across the bottom line of your eye. Doing a reflection is if it's wet. Right there, and then a little bit here. See how that makes it feel wet, even though it's a grayscale eye. Final step for her is back into the shader, the number two shader. Any detail brush you have some good control over. I'm going to go back and make my power up green. Mm-hmm. By the way, at the end of the power up green, we're done. So that's where we're at with this. I'm going to load up my power up green. And in between the shadow of the eye and the lash, I'm going to dab a little green reflection.
Oh, neat. See it? What is that for?
That's to show the magic building up in her body.
Ah.
And I'm going to pull it up a little bit in the corner of the eye and bring some down here. You can even add a little reflection there. And then coming off her eye out of the corner, the magic.
Oh, neat. That is pretty cool.
Right? Little touch that the awesome special effects people of the movie did, and I thought was brilliant, was showing the magic power building up inside her eyes. Somebody sat there and worked very hard in a 3D rendering program to create that. So I thought I'd honor it. Right? Maybe there's a little bit happening down there, and then it just flows out here. Look at that. We are ready to sign her.
Ooh, yeah.
I like to be good. Like, you don't have to sign. This is a thing among artists right now, to sign or not to sign. I might even do a quest on this, but what I'll say at the end of this video is in figurative work, work that looks like something, where you're going to be sharing with friends, family, hanging in local craft shows, local galleries, probably definitely sign.
Yeah.
If you're an abstract artist in a New York gallery, you have already talked to your art agent about signing or not signing. But it's just something that artists think about. Like, does the signature impact my work? How does the signature impact my work? Where should I do it? How should I do it?
Mm-hmm.
And it's good to have that conversation with yourself. It's a good thing. My mom has incredibly strong opinions about signing or not signing.
Oh, no, you got to move it.
As does John.
I like seeing signatures.
He does. He's like the maker's mark.
Yeah.
And since I've started doing this, where we have so many people that do the paintings with me, I've started signing them.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm going to make my little S, and then I'm going to...
You know, some collectors have an emotional connection to the person as much as the art. So
most collectors, in my experience, actually do. Yeah. It's a really sophisticated collector that does not expect your signature.
Yeah.
And again, you generally know who you are.
That has turned out pretty awesome.
Okay, that's all the
So
I'm
thank
so
you
cool, aren't I? So cool
for
and
joining us.
Don't, mature and
don't forget to
you
come
didn't
out.
Even think I was really going to show you guys how to do this, did you? But I did.
Don't forget to join us at TheArtSherpa.com, where we're going to continue this party, and all of our friends are going to go out there and hang out and be posting up their pictures and stuff. And someone asked earlier, TheArtSherpa.com is not just for acrylic paintings. It's for all of your artwork and projects and things. So
yeah,
that's
just
okay.
Whatever you're working on. So yeah. It's just what it, you know. I mean, like we have Facebook, we have Instagram, we have Twitter. I look at stuff there. If you're there, you probably see me comment, like, and engage with something. And you know, we're on Pinterest actively. We're all kinds of places, but TheArtSherpa.com is a place where you can just have a little space and talk to other. Yeah, I like what you say, like-hearted people.
Yeah, people like mind and like heart. So
yeah. And we nom nom likes.
Yes.
Nom nom. That's going to go on for a while. I apologize. Now I got to fix my nails.
All right, guys. We love you. We'll drag on here all day.
Keep being fabulous free spirits. And don't let anyone cut off your wings. And not do nothing about it. Stand up for yourselves. But also know when it's time to put that axe down and let people back into your heart. Love the story of Maleficent. I hope she's a part of your life. And I hope she's a part of your wall. Last Halloween painting that we have is The Corpse Bride.
Mm-hmm. That's coming up. So be prepared.
See Tuesday for that. And who knows what else might just pop up on the channel whenever, because we just do. We have so many paintings to draw.
And we love you guys.
See you at the Easel really soon. Bye-bye.
Bye.